stop at about 7 minutes. It would be good that you can finish within the time. So we'll start with our first presentation. It's by Dr. Azhar Ali Khan from Sheikh Zayed Hospital. It's about post renal transplant polycythemia in response to treatment, a single center study. Dr. Azhar Ali.
Assalamualaikum. A very good morning to all of you. I'm Dr. Azhar Ali Khan, working as consultant nephrologist in Sheikh Zayed Hospital, Lahore. I'm going to talk about my study post renal transplant polycythemia. Patients were excluded from the study who had any previous history of phlebotomy, who were previously taking use ACE inhibitors or ARBs, those who were COPD and had any history of previous rejection or history of native kidney nephrectomy. We have defined post-transplant erythrocytosis as hemoglobin levels of more than 17 gram per deciliter. The patients who developed polycythemia were given ACE inhibitors or ARBs. Some of the patients needed one session of phlebotomy, whereas the other patients were treated in more than two phlebotomy sessions. So out of total 69 patients who were included in the study, majority of the patients were males. Two patients lost to follow-up. You can see that the majority of the patients included in the cohort was a younger population. They all have preserved renal function with normal urine creatinine, and majority of patients were using tacrolimus instead of cyclosporine. So 19 out of 67 patients developed polycythemia in our study. You can see from this slide mean hemoglobin levels at each month by polycythemia status of patient. Those who were non-polycythemic have no baseline hemoglobin level as compared to the polycythemic group. And you can see that hemoglobin levels started rising after 4 months period of time. So this table showed that the patients included in study have normal renal functions. All the patients have baseline GFR of more than 90 ml per minute. And interestingly, few patients, full polycythemic patients, could not tolerate ACE or ARBs and had decline in GFR. But their GFR improved gradually after some period of time after discontinuation of ACE or ARBs. So the non-polycythemic patients were 48 in number, and polycythemic patients who responded only to ACE inhibitors but 11 in number, and resistant or refractory patients to ACE or ARBs who needed multiple sessions of phlebotomy were 5 in number. So these are the 5 patients, polycythemic patients, who needed multiple sessions of phlebotomy at different occasions. 19 patients with a polycythemia after renal transplant, out of which 11 were successfully treated with ACE or ARBs alone, whereas 8 also required phlebotomy sessions. Out of these 8 required treated patients, 3 patients had single session of phlebotomy, whereas others required multiple sessions. The incidence is a bit higher in our study than the previous study done in Pakistan. To the best of our knowledge, by Professor Kim Hamel et al., showed an incidence of 20%. The reason for this higher incidence could be the absence of native kidney nephrectomies, male predominant gender, and absence of rejection episodes. Obviously, there were certain limitations in our study, like erythropoietin levels were not many enough due to normal activity of the center. We have not changed immunosuppressive therapy when the patient were diagnosed to have polycythemia. It was a single center experience with a relatively small sample size. Now I will talk about some reference studies. This study I recently mentioned, it was published in JPMA by Professor Ahmed et al., and they concluded that post-transplant erythrocytosis occurs in male patients for most of their time, and male patients respond to ACE inhibitors perfectly. So you can see that hemoglobin level and hematocrit levels have fallen significantly after the treatment. So this was a Saudi study, and the authors have concluded the same, that the patients had responded well to ACE inhibitor, but few patients also required phlebotomies. These are the baseline characteristics, but you can see they have also taken the patient with acute rejection and transplant in the cirrhosis, which is a different effort. PPE. This is an Indian study, and they have concluded that PPE was observed in 15.5% of transplant patients. So this study was regarding cases or cases and the meta-analysis of different studies showing that there are certain patients who were refractory to the treatment. 83 out of 370 patients were refractory to the treatment. Now talking something about the topic, PD is persistently elevated levels of hematocrit and hemoglobin after renal transplant. It occurs in 10% of graft recipients. Spontaneous remissions occur in 1/4 of the patient, whereas it can be persistent in 3/4 of the patient and only units after the last of renal function. This slide shows the pathogenesis. You can see the ROS and androgens and insulin and growth factors stimulates bone marrow to stimulate more and more erythropoietin. There are certain risk factors which include male gender, smoking, diabetes, retention of native kidneys, and rejection free episodes. So these patients can have variable presentation, mostly asymptomatic, but can present as lethargy, weakness, and headache. Why we are worried about PD? Because it leads to increased serum viscosity, which can lead to artery thrombosis, strokes, and pulmonary edema with significant mortality. ACE and ARBs are mainstay of treatment. Theophylline can be used, but it is not favored. Some patients have been given antiproliferative agents. Phlebotomy is an option, and native kidney nephrectomy can be done in refractory patients. Treatment goal is to keep hemoglobin level less than 17 gram per deciliter. Treatment can be given for indefinite period of time because the condition can be improved if the treatment is stopped. Thank you so much.